and welcome to News and Views. I'm John Banville. Our guest this week is Senator Joe Robach. Senator Robach, thank you very much for making time with us.
Great to be here, and as always, have this opportunity, John, to talk a little bit about what's going on here in Albany in the Capitol.
One of the hottest topics in Albany in the last few months has been corruption. Whether it's be talking about what's happening with the governor's office or in the Senate and the Assembly. Corruption and cleaning up Albany has been on a lot of people's minds. Senator Robach, what is happening to restore integrity to Albany?
Well, certainly I think there's two things. And let me start out by saying, you know, absolutely, with no question, we should put everything in place that we can to make sure we limit any kind of public corruption, especially, and that's what's so hurtful to everyone, I think gets the public upset, but he's an elected official. When people use public money, taxpayer dollars, for the wrong thing, or really use their position of influence to benefit themselves, to me, that's the most egregious of all, and something that should never be tolerated. Now, the good news is that whether it's Sheldon Silver, whether it's been somebody in the Senate, wherever they are, while the vast majority of them have been from New York City, they do seem to be getting caught and getting pretty severe penalties, as they should be. But I would say that, you know, anytime anybody breaks the rule, it's hurtful for the rest of us in elected office, but it certainly infuriates the public. But I feel it's important to say this. I'm going to go through some things I would suggest that would be good rule changes, but understand it is good that under existing rules that people are getting caught, as they should. It, you know, going back to Sheldon Silver, who will come as no surprise to anyone who's followed my political career, you know, I've been odds at that gentleman and thought something wasn't right for really, you know, well over a decade. And then, you know, not being able to put our finger exactly on what it is, but know that legislation was being held up for financial gain, knowing that certain people might get money directed to them for personal financial gain, pretty outrageous. So we need to tighten them up. The one thing that I've heard absolutely the most from the people, and I was a co-sponsor of this bill, is that in addition to any other penalties, and I would point out, you know, Mr. Silver's going to be, they're suggesting 12 years in jail and paying back all the money that was in question, good sentences. But in addition to that, at a point of fairness, that if you're an elected official and you're using your power to gain taxpayer money or using your influence to get government or public money, that you would be eligible for forfeiting your pension. And I went on this bill along with my colleague, Senator Marcelino, and I heard from a lot of people in my district that they thought that was good. You know, don't be afraid to do the right thing. We did that, and with the negotiation of our conference, Leader Flanagan, we had some very public dialogue on this. Even thought we might even be able to put it in the budget, thought we had a three-way agreement with the governor and the assembly. The assembly kind of took a walk on it, added all these other things to it. But I think when you ask the question, what else can be done? Let's make the punishment fit the crime, number one. You lose your pension if you break that trust on things that have to do with public money. And number two, I would make the argument that knowing you're going to lose that, hopefully, for those small amount of people that choose to make those terrible decisions, that it would also further be a deterrent to them to know that, you know, they're going to lose their livelihood down the road for themselves, their spouse, their family, if they choose to really not live up to their obligation and really do something that's very underhanded for their own gain. I think that makes all the sense in the world. And I would say, I have yet to be at a public meeting, a public group, where somebody said they don't really agree with that. So I think It's time for whether you're from New York City, whether you're a Democrat, no matter who you might be, Assembly, you know, join in on this. Let's at least do this part first, what the public thinks makes sense, and really try to put a dent in it, and also even make another statement that this really is intolerable, and you will have some financial skin in the game if you want to do the wrong thing with taxpayer dollars. I think that's a big, big position, and I think you will see mounting commentary in the media, mounting pressure from the public to join the Senate proposal and get that done.
One of the other issues that has come up recently is fundraising, specifically done by the mayor of the city of New York, right, and questions of how money that he was raising was making it to candidates that he supported. Is this being addressed at all, or is this being discussed right now?
Well, that's interesting that you asked that. So there's been a lot written in the media, even about what's going on all over the state, but certainly right in my own backyard. So just so the folks at home understand, under existing law, allegedly, I have to say that because it doesn't sound good, but there has not been a conviction yet.
But questions have been raised about
questions have been raised very publicly that the mayor of New York, for some reason, is concerned with Terrence Murphy's election in upstate New York, or even my good colleague, and I will readily admit this, my friend, a guy I think was doing a great job, Senator Rich Funke. Why would Mayor de Blasio want to steer money into races in upstate New York? We sort of all know the answer is that he wants everything to be New York City centric and just assumes and feels he has the right to steer money against any Republican in upstate New York to try and more get his way, not only in the city of New York, but in the state legislature. Now, under existing statute, that is already against the rules. So now the question will become, you know, will this get investigated? Will this go to court? Will that get vetted and get its day? There are a lot of rules already that I think make sense that I think it would be safe to say always haven't been followed, if not always enforced. So again, there's a lot of people that want to say that the people that did bad things did that because there's a lack of rules. I don't. I hold my colleagues who break that law completely responsible. At the end of the day, they know they're making a bad decision, even under existing rules. So maybe we have to make the penalties a little bit stronger, but equally, you ask a very good question. We have to make sure that we are making sure the rules that are in place, many of which are very good, are being followed. You know, there's no way to say it. I consider it an honor and privilege to have this job, and I hope that everybody in elected office would too. But what we do is critically important and impacts a lot of people. It's viewed by a lot of people. It impacts a lot of people. So it becomes so important that we're as open, transparent, and operate with as much integrity as we can. And I want to tighten it down even further, but I'll say it again. I'm glad that the people that are choosing not to do that, no matter where they come from, who they are, what party, are being looked at and oftentimes being convicted. You can't look at that as bad. Do I wish when they looked at them they weren't doing anything wrong? Absolutely, because it does. You know, again, I grew up in, you know, a family, you know, a lot of grandparents weren't even born here that looked at democracy and government as something very good and why they came here. And the idea that, you know, I can represent a district, get elected, or any other man or woman really should be looked at as an honor and privilege. And I would say this, regardless of what might transpire, intelligent people know what, from day one, I learned it from my mother, I know you can't take money for doing something you're not supposed to. That will get in trouble every time. But we're going to continue down this road to try and make reforms. I think the public's going to get smart to the idea that before you attach all these other things, let's take that pension away, see where we go from there, and take away some of these other wild ideas that they're calling reforms that the public really isn't in favor of, or just clouds the issue.
Very often when you're talking about cleaning up Albany, the idea of taxpayer-funded elections
right.
comes up. What's happening on that? I haven't heard much about that lately.
Right, and you won't from me. So it's very funny because that's exactly what a lot of my liberal colleagues want to attach taxpayer-funded campaigns, what they call public financing of campaigns, to reform. I don't think that's reform at all. As a matter of fact, the vast majority of my colleagues who have been convicted are from New York City that already have that. So to me, ideologically, the idea of taking a couple $100 million of taxpayer money and use to fund campaigns, everybody who wants to run anywhere in the state for statewide office, to me, I would much rather see that money going to offset taxes, going for health care, education, programs for seniors, something more in the government purview. I would even go so far to say the New York City model, which they say by putting money in government or taxpayer-funded dollars into campaigns will somehow take the money out of campaigns, is ridiculous for two ways. You know, my math was, you know, 1 + 1 = 2, 1 + 1 + 1 more = 3. That's more money, not less. But also, they don't even say you can only spend this much money. You can still take the public money and raise above and beyond that. It really, to me, will not do anything except utilize taxpayer dollars in a bad way. And this one, I could say, for the few people, or not the few, the people who are focused on that, outside of a very small sliver, there is strong opposition to the people I represent from using tax dollars on that as opposed to other things that would be, I think, much more beneficial to the public good and what's viewed at as the appropriate things to do with government dollars. I'll just say this. I appreciate everybody's chiming in on, you know, what we can do, but adding more money isn't it. As a matter of fact, I've had a bill for a number of years that would cap the amount of money you could spend on an assembly race and a Senate race, and they said in the 70s they took a concept similar to that all the way up to the Supreme Court, and they viewed it as unconstitutional. I think the time's long overdue to do it again, because since then we've capped how much an individual can give you, how much certain groups can give you, what you can spend in the aggregate, even going back to Mayor de Blasio, how you can steer money from one individual to another to circumvent some of those rules. It's, you know, the time's long come. If you really want to take the money out of politics, let's go the next step and say an individual can't spend more money. Now, a lot of people don't like that because they like millions of dollars being spent on campaigns and makes them feel that they're more influential. But this would impact both parties equally. It would make campaigns, good or bad, be a little bit more grassroots, where you're involved in your community. And I think that if you didn't have unlimited dollars on TV, I think it would lead to more positive campaigning rather than negative campaigning, where if you look at some of the TV commercials, when you get down to the elections, more than 50% of them aren't what an individual is going to do, but trying to disparage the man or woman running against them. I think that's awful. So there are other things we're going to look at, but hopefully, and I really mean this, we're going to do things and we're going to make sure people get caught and do more reforms to try and make sure it's not only limited, but restore the public's trust the best we can.
Senator Robach, I want to thank you very much for taking time out of your busy schedule to discuss ethics reform in a real meaningful way for our viewers. Thank you.
Happy to have the opportunity, John.
We'll see you soon.